الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم وله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى as he gathered us here tonight to always gather us for all goodness, purify our intentions, unite our efforts, fix our deeds, forgive our sins, define our goal, and make us among those who listen and follow the best of what they listen to among men. First, my bachelor degree from Al-Azhar was in English literature, not in Islamic studies. And I just wanted to make sure that that's clear. But alhamdulillah, I was fortunate enough to meet with and study under many of prominent shuyukh. Among them is my Shaykh Dr. Hatem al-Haj, may Allah reward him. Tonight's topic is a very important topic and very intriguing as well. We always think about things, subhanAllah, in black and white sometimes. And always we want to measure things that not necessarily need to be measured. Like we want to measure things that not necessarily need to be measured. It needs to be open. And the other issue also is sometimes we're not looking in the right direction. We're not looking in the right direction. We are looking or trying to find something, but not in the right place. I want to make that clear, inshallah. So when we talk about the balance between dunya and deen, between living in this world and living in akhirah and all that, would this be the right approach to approach that, like to say that there should be a balance and how can we find the balance? Or we see how Quran, subhanAllah, approached the matter. So when I read at the end of, I don't know, maybe Sheikh already said that, but at the end of Surah Al-Qasas, the story of Qarun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that when he was so attached to this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the people of knowledge told him, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. The word is, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. يعني don't forget your share of dunya. That means the assumption is that a good person would be forgetting the share of the dunya, because they're focused on the akhirah. So the ayah here is saying, no, just take care of your dunya as well, but to serve your akhirah. Right? So that's actually the balance. Because you know the dunya here is a transient place, a place of transition. Transient in itself, that it will fade away, but it is a place of transition as well that we go through to al-akhirah. So, I wanted, instead of talking to you, like this one-way traffic, we want to make it a little bit interesting. So, me and Shaykh Hatem, inshallah, will be discussing a few points that inshallah will clarify what I just mentioned. That are we looking in the right direction when we're saying that there has to be a balance? Are we really measuring something that should not be measured or not? That's how, inshallah, the discussion will go. I wanted to share with you some personal experience first. Maybe first time you're hearing about myself. I never wanted to be a sheikh. Actually, I was fighting all the way until I graduated from Al-Azhar University not to be a sheikh. That's the point I'm trying to tell you, looking what direction, what you're good at, what you should do. So then at the end I became a sheikh. I didn't want to become a teacher. The last thing I wanted was a teacher, but I ended up becoming a teacher. And everybody telling me, oh, you're a good teacher, you're my teacher, you're a good teacher. I said, no, just you say that. When you start looking on the right direction and looking at the purpose of your very existence in this dunya, subhanAllah, then things become clear for you. The balance will come by itself. But this balance is a relative thing. It is not like, I do this here, and I do this here. And then if I do one here, I have to do one here. If you're talking to the brothers, you have to be talking to the sister. If there is brotherhood, then you have to call sisterhood. You know, this kind of approach to things actually make us miss the bigger picture. The bigger picture. I was talking in a lecture one time, and the brother said, Sheikh, say sisterhood as well. I said, why? When you say brotherhood, l'ukhuwa, it includes the brothers and the sisters. وَرَسُولُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ النِّسَاءُ شَقَائِقُ الرِّجَالِ. And everything that you talk about, then it applies to women, unless there is some, you know, some more elaboration on this one. But they are included. So why do you have to be always politically correct? And that's how the balance will come. Right? So the same thing, you are in the dunya, but you go to the akhirah. The balance is to live the way Allah Azza wa Jal is telling you. So you don't want to do certain things, and you end up doing. So you ask yourself, is it right or wrong? And then you will find that the balance coming, subhanAllah, in your life, and the vision becomes clearer and clearer every day. Not necessarily what you like or what you dislike. What you like or what you dislike. So inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, I know Shaykh Hatem talked already, and I'm sure that he covered the aspect from the subject from all different aspects. And I feel bad that I missed the lecture. I had to go for an emergency, and alhamdulillah, that now. So, engaging the Shaykh, inshallah, talking to him. Shaykh, I always see, subhanAllah, that we as Muslims focus on the external aspect of things. The external aspect of things. So everybody like wants to study fiqh. Study fiqh. Then they go take a course in fiqh and study the fiqh of tahara, the fiqh of worship, the fiqh of this, the fiqh of that. They want to take a course in aqidah. They study the aqidah and all of that. As if I use your terms, studying the guidelines of the science instead of studying the science. So, using that perspective, when we talk and say the balance of the dunya and the deen, how can we relate this? Like, are we really want the balance, means do this and do that, or it is beyond this?
When I began my talk, I said that the title itself, you could critique the title. You could say that the title is a bad title. That's one way of doing it, because ultimately there is no such thing like balancing out the deen in the dunya or the dunya in the akhirah, because you would be, like I said in the lecture, you'd be utterly crazy if you try to strike a balance between the transient and the everlasting, the transient abode here in the dunya and the everlasting one in the hereafter. But the other way of looking at the title is to try to dissect the person that chose this title. And certainly the title, we all know the title, because it was emailed to me, and I did not comment on it, because I did not want to correct it when it may be correct, or some of its implications may be correct. So the person that suggested this title must have never meant that the dunya and the akhirah are equal.
No.
And we're trying to balance it between two equals. He meant to say, how do you balance between the different commitments, the different engagements? How do you divide your time between the necessary work for the dunya, because we all have to work and sustain ourselves and our families, and work for the betterment of our communities, and work for the various furud al-kifayat, or the collective obligations in the ummah, to have the doctors and to have the social workers and to have the teachers and to have the engineers, and so on and so forth. How do you balance between, it's a matter of balancing the time allocation. Now that it's not a balance of pursuit, because your entire pursuit should be directed to the hereafter. You're mainly desirous of the hereafter, longing for the hereafter, intent on the hereafter, paying your attention and you focusing on the hereafter. On your way, to take care of your dunya, because you will need your dunya for the work of the hereafter.
So how can we change the title? If we might change the title, is the word balance is the issue, or the relationship between dunya and akhirah is the issue?
No, I think it is about the word balance is fine.
I'll tell you why we are focusing on the topic in a minute.
Yeah.
Right? This is very important. You know, I'll tell you in a minute why we're focusing on the topic.
It is balancing your work, the division of time.
So the word balance,
time allocation between the work of the dunya and the work of akhirah, but it is not balancing of the your desire or your pursuit or your seeking both.
Why do you say like if I say I'm living a balanced life, but I work 14 hours or 16 hours a day, I sleep very little, I eat very little, I do other things. Can I call this a balanced life? If I'm happy with it, like it's balanced? Like, what I wanted to reach is like, the word balance, not necessarily means equal quantities in both sides.
Oh, absolutely, yes, absolutely.
The title becomes correct if you think like that. So the balance is not the, like, I do this here and I do that here.
Yes.
But the balance is, if I use the dunya properly to reach akhirah, I have a balanced life.
Yes.
Am I right?
Because you're balancing between the work, you know, the dunya work and the akhirah work. You're not balancing between your desire for the dunya and the desire for the akhirah. Or your pursuit, or your seeking of the dunya and seeking of the akhirah. Because if it is about the pursuit or the seeking of the dunya and the akhirah, then it is not imaginable that I would worry about balancing. I am all about the akhirah. You know, how long will this dunya last? This is the quick passing, short, transient one, and I'm working for the akhirah. I am walking towards my final destination. But in that journey, on that journey, I do need to take care of my dunya for various reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Personal reasons, common reasons, Ummah at large reasons, for various reasons, I do need to take care of my dunya. So it's about the time division, allocation of time. And if I was talking about if there is like a heart surgeon that is working 12 hours a day, or a scientist in the lab, you know, that is working 12 hours a day in his lab, if this person is not forgiven about the fara'id Allah, لا يتعدى حدود الله لا يضيع فرائض الله, he's not overstepping the bounds
balance
of Allah, he's not abandoning or deserting the fara'id of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does have enough knowledge to be sort of to live his life as a good Muslim and to practice his profession as a Muslim and to go to Hajj and be able to perform it when he goes to Hajj and to treat his wife like a good Muslim woman treats his wife. If he's doing this and he's taking care of his wife and taking care of his kids and giving them some time, because so give everyone his due right. And if he's doing all of this, this person is a balanced person. And this person, I cannot say that he is pursuing the dunya. This person may be pursuing the hereafter just as you and I are doing this in the middle of our da'wah activities and our teaching and traveling to give courses and seminars. He may be more desirous of the akhirah than us.
That brings us to the next point. Is like when we were talking about this lecture, there was two aspects. One is how internally you become balanced. And then the other aspect is how externally you become balanced, following the Sunnah of Rasulullah. And what the Shaykh said is what you just mentioned just now is exactly what everybody needs to hear. Because the problem is we have certain image of who should be the practicing Muslim. Who should be a practicing Muslim? And everybody start measuring themselves according to it. Am I above? Am I equal? So they see Dr. Hatem, that's the image of a sunnah of Rasulullah, which is right. But that's, is that the only image? No?
Unfortunately, it's
not. No, it isn't. They, I hope, I have like an image or a representation of the Sunnah of Rasulullah to a certain extent. But the problem, do you see this as an issue here? That people see an image and they think this is the only limited image. You can be, each one of you can be an image of the Sunnah of Rasulullah if you invest on it. And it become right. Do you agree with this?
It's not even to that extent. You know, I want to take it further to say that people, even when it comes to the different works of the Athira, relief work, teaching, this and that, people also have a very contracted awareness about the works of the Athira. So unless you are preaching, unless you are preaching from the pulpit, you have not reached the peak of it. The peak is to basically preach from the pulpit. It is to stand on the minbar and to give khutbah al-jum'ah, and everybody comes to you and asks you questions. And then people will start to say, is he a faqih or he just a da'i? And then you further contract it, constrict it. So, and keeps it going to the... But that is completely wrong.
Absolutely.
That's absolutely wrong. Because if you're doing, the, you know, Sheikh Abdul Rahman Smaid, rahmanullah, Dr. Abdul Rahman Smaid, he was a Kuwaiti doctor, physician, who graduated from a very prestigious university in Canada, and he dedicated his life to da'wah in Africa. About 5 million people, the numbers vary, people report different numbers, but about 5 million people were converted to Islam because of his work. He was not a khatib, he was not a faqih, he was an ordinary guy, he was a physician, but he had concern for the ummah. And he felt that Africa, most of us du'a, we go to Sweden, we go to the US, you know, to give da'wah in the US. Because,
you give da'wah in Sweden.
And you may have good intentions, you want to give, but you're also coming to the US to give da'wah. And you're not going to the Central Republic of whatever, because there is, you know, there are reasons. There must be some reasons you choose this over that. But he felt that the void and the need is there, and he went there, and he started to do his work there. And 5 million people and their progeny will be in his scale of good deeds. So
that balance.
So is he better or the, you know, I'm not saying that he's better than the faqih, because the faqih may be better, but I'm saying that you cannot say that the faqih is better than him.
No. So that the point we're trying to emphasize here is finding that balance. You have to look within yourself and see what you are the best at and try to fit in the puzzle of the bigger community. That's how the community becomes balanced, if you are from inside. Now, Sheikh, before I go to the next point, I told you that why we are focusing on the topic. Our fuqaha or our ulama, whenever they define something, they make ta'rif jam' mana. Ta'rif jam' mana. Yani jam' it becomes inclusive of whatever they want to say. And exclusive of everything that they don't want people to misunderstand. That's the importance of topics. The importance of titles. So we have fancy titles for seminars and conferences and everything. But we don't really have an idea what it's all about. That's why we are discussing on the topic. We spend some time on the topic. Sheikh, the next point, proving your that theory. You know, education, they say that education in the United States, for example, went through 3 major eras. Okay? Now, we have to understand that these people are not religious. The people we're talking about, they're not religious. So don't feel that I believe in that, right? So they are saying that the first education is called cultural transmission. Transmission. You don't question, you don't say, you know, the person tells you, you have to accept it, student, teacher, we all know that. And then the next, so the purpose of education at that time was just to give information to people. And the second era was this era of citizenship. So they're saying that, you know, education was to make you a better citizen of the environment you are in. The third era, which is now, they're saying education becomes successful when it is about doing. The Sheikh said it's about doing, when you're doing, instead of talking, and talking, right? it is about doing. So those who do, actually the ones who are the effective ones. So if we are talking about balances and relating what the theory I just mentioned, where are we? Which state of this?
I think that we have a lot of difficulties and challenges to be balanced people. The first difficulty and challenge, like I said before in the lecture, is the fact that our certainty of the antenna is not at all at the level where we could be balanced. We cannot be balanced because the akhira to us is so abstract and non-tangible versus the dunya that is like here and now. The akhira is so abstract and non-tangible that we cannot become balanced until we grow our certainty of the akhira and the akhira becomes as visible as the dunya, as tangible as the dunya for us. It used to be like this for the Sahaba. They used to see it like they saw, the day and night, the Jannah and Nar.
Can we reflect on a couple of stories in this regard?
Visibility of the Anas ibn Nadr al-Wahid, where he said that I smell the fragrance of the paradise.
That question had been asked in Hajj. People said, was he really physically smelling, or he was just
rhetorically speaking? He was not right. He was believing in it to the extent that it became a physical experience. This is the experiential faith versus the intellectual faith that we have, versus the basically theoretical faith that we have. It's experiential. He believed in it to the point that it became a physical experience. And this is quite normal. If you study psychology, and you would know that people can sometimes move objects by, from a distance. So you could transfer the belief into a physical force or a physical experience. It becomes so tangible that he actually sees it. He actually feels it, hears it, smells it, tastes it, and it would be a real experience for him. He said, "I'm smelling."
So actually, then I started seeing the problem with using the word balance.
In order for us to be balanced, we have to ask ourselves that question. Do you feel, do you have certainty in the akhirah like the certainty that you have in the dunya? Do you have as much certainty in the akhirah, and the akhirah, and the jannah, and the nar, and the Day of Judgment, and the Reckoning, and the Suhuf, the Scriptures, and the Sirat, the path on, across the hellfire? Do you see it like you're seeing this bottle of water here? Do you see it? We don't. I don't. Then until we get to that point, that your belief becomes at that level of certainty, you're not yet balanced. So you're working to become balanced. But then, when your belief is at that level of certainty, it does not mean that you will abandon your work, that if you are an architect, or if you are a surgeon, or if you are a programmer, or whatever you are, that you're not gonna take care of your work. If this is where you're talented, serve the ummah through this. The very verse that you said, وَبِتَغِي فِي مَا أَتَكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ
الْآخِرَةِ,
and seek through that which Allah had given you. Yes. If you have gifted hands, like Ben Carson claims he has gifted hands, regardless of my opinion of Ben Carson, but if you have gifted hands,
ask his patience.
That is, then use that asset. Serve the ummah through your gifted hands. Through your gifted hands. If you are a good architect, help us out. Serve the ummah. Help yourself, the other people, community, and so on and so forth.
Can we say then, instead of looking for personal balance, we look for collective balance?
And we need that as well. We need that very much. And that is a very, very important...
Because sometimes you're looking for the personal balance, you'll not achieve it. And everyone is like looking for his own personal balance, but we forget what the community does. We're not moving in the same direction.
That is why. This is part of our fatwa, by the way. Because we have collective obligations. And Imam al-Nawawi says, كَعِلْمَ الطُّبِّ وَالْحِسَابِ. You know, فُرُودِ الْكِفَاءَ كَعِلْمَ الطُّبِّ وَالْحِسَابِ. Imam al-Nawawi says, some of the collective obligations like the science of medicine and math. It's a collective obligation. The ummah, there has to be mathematicians. There has to be physicians. And there has to be everything, you know. And because of this, we would be all sinners if you don't have enough mathematicians, if you don't have enough physicians, if you don't have this or that. And because of this, many of us need to be active in da'wah, which I do. The one thing that I did not talk about, I'm talking about the ordinary people. But there must be a group of us that will sacrifice a lot of the dunya to do the work of da'wah because we have deficiency there.
Hint, hint, building blocks.
We have a great deficiency in da'wah, in relief work, in activism, generally. We have a great deficiency in those areas, in teachers, in fuqaha, in khutaba, in every. We have a great need, a great void, huge. So when someone says that I will be an average physician, mm-hmm. an average physician, and I will excel in those areas.
Da'wah,
relief, I will lead a relief organization, I will, you know, pursue...
But he wants to be average.
He wants to be a faqih, mm-hmm. because you cannot be excellent at both.
That comes from doctor, by the way, doctor. And he's excellent in both, and that's what I say.
You really cannot be excellent at both. You will have to give sort of. It is extremely important that you will be good at both, but you cannot be excellent at both.
Okay.
You cannot be a leading, you know, pediatric scholar in America, and at the same time, a jurist, or aspire to be, you know, a jurist. It is just not going to work out. So in this case, you have to be a good pediatrician, because otherwise, as a Muslim, that you know, who's like, you can't even be a mediocre pediatrician. You have to be a good pediatrician.
You're not allowed to be a good pediatrician.
Yeah, you certainly should not be a bad one, because you will hurt the dean, you will hurt the dean, you'll hurt the reputation of the dean, you will hurt the image of the Muslims. You'll be doing so much harm and damage. That you claim to try to be countering. So you can't be bad, for sure, but you also cannot be mediocre, because you're still a Muslim, and so you should be above average. But in order for you to be leading in both fields, you're not going to be able to do it. It's just like a matter of math, scientifically speaking. So here, we need...
So the balance will not be established.
The balance is established regardless of your allocations. I am in, you know, focused on the hereafter, desirous of the hereafter, longing for the hereafter, on my way to my final destination, depending on the time, the place, the needs of the ummah, my personal capacities, my personal talents, my education, whatever my father chose for me. Your father chose for you to teach you Quran, and you became a memorizer of the Quran at age 10. And your father sent you to Al-Azhar. And you know, because you, and then Shaikh Mamdouh also has the ijazah, a high ijazah in the 10 recitations of the Quran, so he's not just any memorizer of the Quran. In this case, it would be waste of resources that you become anything but a sheikh and a teacher.
That's why I became a sheikh and a teacher.
Yeah. Because
I had no choice.
No, because so much was already invested in this. So much was already invested in this. It would be a great waste of resources. Likewise, if someone became a good heart surgeon, he should not go back and say, Shaykh Mamdouh, I want you to teach me Ad-Rumayya, and I want, because I want to begin my career of, I want to become a jurist. You, if you are like a very competent heart surgeon, most likely you will not be able, you're already here. You have not started, you're coming now at age 45, and because everybody is so dazzled by fiqh and the fuqaha, and ultimately it is the person that people will go to ask questions. Because it's all about the exterior, it's all about we're like,
and that's not new.
It's like an act, it's like a stage of actors, and it's really bad. So that is what we're after. It's about your role on the stage.
So you'll never achieve balance if you are focusing on the exterior.
Yes,
but exterior is important as a reflection to the interior.
Yeah. But after you have determined your priorities, now you have to study your needs, your talents, your capacities, the time, the place, the needs of the ummah, the needs of your own community, and then you decide, should I devote myself to da'wah and make my work a means of sustenance, but at the same time, I will not be a lousy worker, I will not be a lousy architect, I will not be a lousy physician, I will not be a lousy janitor, I will not be a lousy anything, because I'm a Muslim and I'm an ambassador of this religion in front of the people that would see my work. So I will not be lousy and I will not be mediocre. I will be good, I'll be above average, but I will focus on da'wah, relief, seeking knowledge, teaching, fiqh, this or that, and I will be okay with, less income, like a smaller income, and I will be okay with just being above average, and I may not reach the peak or the pinnacle of my career because I need to focus here because there is a huge need here. That would be valid. But if someone does not have the talent to be a da'i, and he has the talent of being a good surgeon or a good architect or a good this or that, and he pursues being a da'i, he should ask himself, but this is misplacement of resources, mismanagement of resources. You should ask yourself, why are you doing it? And you should check out your intentions. Why am I doing it? Am I doing it for the sake of Allah? Or am I doing it because I like celebrity? I like, to have a position in the community, to have a status in the community. And if that is what we like, there's a hadith that, you usually say that be a candle. The Prophet ﷺ told you, don't be a candle. The candle
burns itself.
Yeah,
for people to see. Don't be a bridge that people cross. Jannah, you go to hellfire.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a hadith is reported by Tabarani from Jundub ibn Abdullah said, "مثل العالم الذي يعلم الناس الخير وينسى نفسه كمثل السراج يضيء للناس ويحرق نفسه."
Opposite of what the people think.
Yeah,
you should be a candle. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Never be a candle."
Don't be a candle. The likeness of the teacher, the scholar, who teaches the people good and forgets himself, is like a candle that provides light for the people, but it burns itself. It burns itself. So the scholar who's teaching the people good and forgetting himself is a candle that provides light, but it is burning. And you should not be a candle. I mean, you should be a lamp that will, is basically what is sustainable energy.
So you get your energy and give back.
Renewable, whatever energy.
So let's forget about the word, this balance word for a little bit here. And should if we say, if we remember when building blocks started, since we are here 10 years from building blocks, when we were in Minnesota, the work were different, and the thought Shaikh Hatem, Brother Hazan, Brother Saeed, and a few other brothers, that why we don't have an initiative that brings all this together. So instead of the work, as the Sheikh mentioned, is focused on one and abandoning other things, what somebody else is doing, why we don't have something that brings everywhere together? That was the idea actually of the building blocks, and that's what's called building blocks. You know, everyone is a block in that building, and then it helps everybody, but no one can claim it. Okay, so do you think, Sheikh, our need for collective work, our need for collective thinking, is imminent now more than any other time?
It's absolutely imminent. I have not, you know, it is in the history of this Ummah, we seldom had this diaspora that we have nowadays. I was reading an article by Haroon Mogul. You know Haroon Mogul? Yeah. I was reading an article. People think that he's liberal, but he is liberal, but he's a good brother. He has, like, good thoughts, and he... And this liberal guy that people call liberal, he wrote an article recently about maybe the only way to fight ISIL is to have a true caliphate. So he was that was basically his hypothesis, and then he examined that hypothesis, and then he constructed. You know, his conclusion at the end of the article is that it is true. That the only way to fight the caliphate is to have a true one. Because the Muslims are living in a diaspora and they don't have a collective mind. They don't have any form of structure, hierarchy, organization. But we have to think, you know, part of the balance also is to understand your size and your position, and don't get overwhelmed by the cosmic things when you can't take care of your own family. Some people get overwhelmed because of the cosmic tribulations Muslims are going through. He himself is not taking good care of his family. He's a lousy husband, or she is a lousy wife. Because it's not only because, you know, with
husband are not the only one.
The trends that we have now is that the husband is always the lousy one. Sometimes it's not true. You know, sometimes it's the lousy husband, sometimes it's a lousy wife.
Sometimes so, both are lousy.
Sometimes both.
Yeah. But then the kids are like...
But you know. if you cannot fix your own affairs and the affairs of your own family, and you cannot be a good father or a good husband or a good wife, you're not... Most likely, you're not going to be able to solve the problems, the cosmic problems Muslims are facing. So don't be overwhelmed by that. Take care of this first, and then go out from here. So taking care of our community here in America, we don't have a collective mind. Do we have a collective mind?
No,
we don't have a collective mind.
And we're afraid to have one. So if Sheikh Hatem comes to my small organization in Houston and tells me that you do this, oh, you're going to run my business for me now? And I'm not saying it as a joke, I'm saying it as a fact. And you can reflect on that here in Minnesota. And I say the same in Houston. And unless we start this kind of conversation openly, we're not going to go anywhere, by the way. So, Arab community, Somali community, Pakistani community, Desi community, everybody's afraid that the other one is threatening my very existence. And they're going to come to take over my organization. And that's why the problem happens around, and then we forget about the importance of this collective mind. So if we can move now to see what would be practical steps to bring the balance to the community in Minnesota, for example, in Twin Cities, as building blocks, as the Muslims sitting here, brothers and sisters, how can we bring that balance in the community? What people should look for? Do I have to go to Fajr like every day, start doing that now? Do I have to start a Quran class, take my kids to Islamic school, attend more lectures in the masjid, volunteer in building blocks? What should we do to start creating that balanced community?
Well, in terms of should, you should do all the above. But in terms of what you can do is...
Where we start? Yeah. Where we start? I mean, simple.
Yeah.
We talked about the general concepts. Let's talk about specific steps now.
So, yeah, your personal development is very important because if you are a weak stem, you cannot support the sprouts. Right or wrong? The likeness of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and those who are with him is like a وَمَثَلَهُمْ فِي الْإِنْجِيلِ and their parable or likeness in the Injil and the Gospel is like a plant that gave forth its blade or sprout and supported it until it grew strong and was able to stand on its stem. So, being a weak person, Allah, that's why the Prophet said, "Mu'min al-qawi khayrun wa ahabbu ila Allah min al-mu'min al-da'if wa fi kulli al-khayr." The strong believer is more beloved to Allah than the weak believer, and but there is goodness in both. But being weak yourself, being weak intellectually, being weak spiritually, being weak even economically, you're not going to be able to support another person spiritually if you're weak spiritually, intellectually if you're weak intellectually, financially if you're weak financially. You're not going to be able to support because you're weak. So the personal development is important. Most importantly, the spiritual one. That's our foundation. Because the interior is the foundation of the exterior. And if you have like a bad interior, you have a bad foundation, the building will ultimately collapse. But if you have a good foundation, it will be a short building if you don't build on it on that many levels. But personal development is important. For the community in Minnesota, for the community in Minnesota, I think one of the good things that could be done is to not threaten one another as organizations, but have a round table for the organizations. Because that round table, that meeting of the organizations, will basically result in the making of that collective mind. The final outcome, you know, will be the collective mind. Because we sit together and we see where the deficiencies are, and then we fill in the gaps. Without threatening one another, you know.
So that's the keyword.
Yes.
No threat.
Yeah.
Yes. So in conclusion, inshallah, I want to share with you, when the Sheikh used the word sprouting and all of that, I know some of you are smiling, you know what I'm going to say next, right? That very area was a reason for me to start a small organization in Houston. It's called Roots and Sprout. Roots and Sprout. Without the roots, you cannot have good sprouts. And you cannot say that we focus on the roots all the time. There has to be some sprouts, some results come in. But I'll share with you one model that I succeeded to relate to what the Sheikh said. And maybe this is something, inshallah, we can take and work on. So I have a class that it is kind of coaching for advanced activists or imams. I have about 30, 35 people from around the world. They attend that class online, and I have about seven in Houston itself. The point that they come, that they study, but we talk like this all the time. And with that talk, they take it back to their communities, and subhanAllah, you see things coming up. I said, for example, that this one. The second thing I said, all right, Quran, everybody loves Quran. Everybody wants an imam to lead them in Taraweeh, right? But the problem is, you just want that for the occasion. How about I change the standard of Quran in the city of Houston? Okay? So I said, okay, I have an ijazah. You come, you recite the Quran with me from 9 months to 12 months. I'm going to make you a good, you know, performer in the dissertation and all that. Bismillah ta'ala, you'll have an ijazah. You know, now in Houston, before last Ramadan, when people are looking for a reciter to lead the Quran. They ask him, do you have ijazah or not? And this is not a joke, this is true. The standard before was just somebody to read Quran and get over with. Then, do you know tajweed or not? Now, do you have ijazah or not? Okay, maybe later the preference would be for the one who knows more than one qira'ah. Okay, so what I'm trying to say here, that this investment is very, very important. What the Sheikh said, that you cannot have good sprout or with a weaker stem. Okay, so that's what I think we need to work on now. So in conclusion, the balance has to be collective. The balance has to be community-wide. The balance can be achieved when each one of us realize their attitudes, their strengths and their weaknesses, and when we start completing each other, when we are not threatened by each other as organizations, when we don't judge each other. I remember Shaykh Hatem said something, and I was sharing it with him a few years back, and actually this changed the way I perceived things, that somebody was criticizing a certain group in a certain fiqh school in Islam. And then the Sheikh said, don't criticize them like that. Maybe they execute things wrong. Maybe they have some issues. But we do not doubt that they love Islam as much as we do. See that? That's very deep. Right? They love Islam. Maybe they're expressing it wrong, but they love it more than we do. So that's the balance, my brothers and sisters, that the building blocks we're talking about tonight, 10 years commemorating the start of the building blocks. So inshallah, Shaykh Hatem inshallah give some closing remark as well. But my closing remark is, the balance is a relative thing for you as an individual. You know, when you really make that body tired, I'm using Shaykh Hatem's word also back, building blocks classes. When you make this body tired for the sake of Allah in a positive way, Shaykh was sharing with me earlier, make it, that's balance. When you stand in front of Allah Azza wa Jalla at night, that's balance. When you fast during the day, that's balance. When you're really tired physically, but you're achieving something for the sake of Allah, that's balance. When you be good at your job, that's balance. When you're supporting your brother in something that he's weak, or your sister in something she's weak, and you, that's balance. So let's focus on balance between dunya and deen from that perspective, inshallah. It's not two equal portions here and there, but it is how you look at things. Akhirah is your goal. You become the best on what you do, not threatened by each other. Let's work together collectively. Let's have more efforts with organizations like Building Block. Somebody, mashallah, in education, let's support them. Somebody in relief, let's support them. Somebody in the civil rights, support them. Let's do all of that. And we all move collectively in the same direction, as I was saying in the khutbah today, Sheikh. Maybe someone on the right, maybe someone on the left, maybe someone back, maybe someone front, maybe someone faster than the other. But we all as a community moving forward. But if we start focusing on, no, everybody has to be in that side, or everybody has to be in that side, or you have to be slow because I'm slow, or you have to catch up with me because I'm fast, then we are not actually moving. So that's my closing statement about balance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all balanced. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us of what we said and what we heard tonight.
That's a very good closing, so nothing could be better, except Allah saying, فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ. When you're done with your occupation,
there you go.
Labor in the worship of your Lord.
So the Sheikh, وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حَدِيثًا وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا. Nobody can say anything after the Quran. Alhamdulillah. Zakullah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.